Every year, in order to ensure the survival of their species and the passing on of genetic material to future generations of little baby seedlings, plants all over the world produce intricate and well-designed flowers to ensnare those matchmakers of the animal kingdom, pollinators. Bees, wasps, flies, butterflies, hummingbirds, bats, creatures of all shapes and sizes have co-evolved with plants to make sure they don't miss this life-affirming connection. Pollination is the first step in sexual reproduction of seed plants. Most angiosperms have perfect flowers, which contain both male and female reproductive organs. But some produce imperfect flowers. An imperfect flower has only male or only female reproductive organs. In either scenario, the name of the game is getting the male portion of the flower, or the pollen, over to the sticky stigma of the female portion of the flower so that it can travel down and fertilize the ovum inside. Flowers that rely on biotic factors like animals, insects, birds, usually have some sort of attractive quality to them. Whereas flowers that rely on abiotic factors, that is non-living factors, are of a different design. But flowers of wind-pollinated plants typically have very small or no petals, making it easier for airborne pollen to come in contact with the sticky stigma. Wind-dispersed pollen is smoother and lighter than other types of pollen. Wind-pollinated plants produce massive amounts of pollen, a fact which people with allergies are well aware. That's right, all that green stuff on your cars and your nose and your eyes making you itch and cry. Plant sperm, you are the unfortunate accidental victim of plant reproduction. Most plants, that is about 80% of flowering plants and over 33% of crop plants, depend on biotic or animal-assisted pollination. And this is where our delightful little yentas come in. Plants have found various ways of attracting these animal species to their flowers to aid in pollination. They can attract pollinators by offering food, by having an appealing appearance, fragrance, or even by deception. Most of these relationships are mutualistic. A plant-pollinator relationship is mutualistic because both plants and pollinators benefit from their interaction. Many flowers produce nectar, which is a sugary liquid located at the base of the flower to attract pollinators to the flower. Hummingbird-pollinated flowers contain large amounts of nectar, which hummingbirds depend on for energy. Some plants produce pollen of high nutritional value for ants and bees. These plants have to produce large amounts of pollen to ensure that not all pollen is eaten, but that some is carried to receptive flowers. When a bee enters a flower and begins to gather pollen, some pollen will stick to the hairs on its body. The pollen on its body is then transferred to other flowers that it visits in the same foraging trip. Some flowers rely on visual attraction. Plants attract pollinators based on their flower's shape, size, color, and nectar guides. One of the easiest ways to get a sense of the type of pollinators that visit a flower is by looking at that flower's shape and size. Shape is important. For example, some flowers have tubular shapes. Some are spurred. And both of these shapes are suited to pollination by hummingbirds or butterflies with a long proboscis, which allows them to reach the nectar at the base of the corolla tube or spur. Shallow flowers with large open petals act as a landing pad for bumblebees. Color is also an important part of attraction. A flower's color can give you a big clue as to what type of pollinator it attracts. Hummingbirds, for example, are attracted to red and yellow flowers. Butterflies are drawn to red, yellow, orange, pink, and purple flowers. Nocturnal pollinators, such as bats and moths, will visit pale-colored or white flowers that remain opened all night and are easiest to see in the dark. Some flies prefer flowers that are dark red, purple, or spotted because they resemble rotting flesh. Yummo. Bees are attracted to whites, yellows, blues, and purples, and they can even see ultraviolet patterns on flowers that humans cannot see. These are called nectar guides. And bees are also drawn to flowers by these guides, which are patterns that direct them to the center of the flower where the pollen and nectar are located. Another mode of attraction is odorous attraction, or smell. Some produce very fragrant flowers to attract pollinators. Flowers that we normally think of as pleasant-smelling produce these scents to attract butterflies, bats, moths. Some flowers produce scents so strong they can be detected by insects more than half a mile away. But not all odors are pleasant. Some, like that of the corpse flower, produces a scent like rotting flesh, again to attract those pollinators, like flies. In summary, plants attract pollinators with specialized structures in order to affect the probability of successful reproduction. Some examples of those ways that plants have evolved include providing food such as nectar and pollen, the shape of the flower, the color of the flower, nectar guides, and special odors. Now, let's solve our first flower mystery. What do you think this flower was made for? What structures do you see that could be a perfect fit for one of the pollinators that we've talked about? Notice the colors, the shapes. What clues is this flower giving you as to the perfect matchmaker for it?
Matchmaker, matchmaker, make me a match. Find me a find, catch me a catch. Matchmaker, matchmaker, look through your book and make me a perfect match. Matchmaker, matchmaker, I'll